There is not a world where I would walk into the office and go, entrepreneurship, like chewing glass, no money in the bank, boom. But we would do that online.
The truth is, they're all lying. That also comes from a place of being very close to a lot of people who create this kind of content. You should pay no attention to it whatsoever.
Negativity sells. And the problem is, often we don't consider the cost of our communication. Everything you do is held to account. I don't want to go work for a founder that is burnt out.
I try and be very disciplined about not paying any attention to personal brand or entrepreneurial content anymore. And that is because there is an industry around it.
So you're telling me that Gary Vee isn't obsessed and spending all his spare time searching through garage sales to make £3. You're telling me that there's industry behind everything we see online. Get out of here.
The thing is, I don't watch any of those people, so I don't know.
In this week's Memes and Machines, we talk about growth hacks. Why Billie Eilish invited the entire world to become her close friend? Was this marketing genius, or was this an overreach from Meta? We talk about Web3, a term you may or may not be familiar with, questing, pros, cons. We dive into KPIs, measurement, the dangers of misguided incentives. We talk about personal brand and some of the unhealthy habits that are forming as part of this industry. And finally, we conclude with a deep dive on LinkedIn. What is going on the app? Why is it continuing to innovate? What does the future hold? And what do you need to pay attention to now?
An earthquake and a lunar eclipse in 1 week. What can you learn as a marketing leader?
That was smooth. That was actually probably the smoothest thing you've said in a while. Your one-liners haven't been great the last couple of weeks, but that one.
All right. Back on form.
Back on form. You can't keep the Catman down for long. Catman, it's good to see you. Normally when we speak, it is very dark for me, but I got a little bit of light peeking in through the window. It's nice.
Yeah, I feel like spring has sprung. Has the seasonal depression washed away?
Not yet, not yet. Unfortunately, as a Brit that hasn't abandoned his country, I have to suffer the consequences of living on a very unpredictable, often grey, rainy island that I will say is quite bright and sunny today. And I've walked a different path from my usual route, and I just feel like I'm in a different city. You know when you walk the same places, but you just get a glimpse of sun and you're like, this place is rather cool. I'm getting those, to your point, spring vibes.
Yeah, I love that. We also had we had the eclipse yesterday in the US, which was very exciting.
Did everyone go to like the space in New York where there's that? Is that where the sun hits a certain spot and then everyone gets their camera out? Or
well, I mean, people just gathered in any open spot they could. So the parks are full, and we went out to our street, and there was, you know, people just lining the street staring at the sun. But for me, it's always those moments are always a good reminder of why I enjoy being in the US, right? Where like suddenly everyone's like talking to each other, they're like cracking jokes. It's like a very kind of just being from England and then going to the US, you get this real contrast of like people are just like very open to chatting to strangers here. And in those moments, I love being out and about because it's like times 10. Like everybody's so excited. There's you know, something to break up the day a little bit. We had the earthquake last week as well, which again had similar feeling. It just kind of, you know, broke the ice between strangers. And it's a nice reminder of why I like being here, because it forces you to interact with your community in a way that I don't think you see in Europe, really.
You were trying to say that Americans like talking about themselves in public and oversharing. Dude, I can't recall the number of times that I've been in the US and you will seemingly, you know, when you're kind of observing or just trying to listen what's happening around you, the amount of times that you would assume that they are long lost connections or best friends, but it's two people that have never met, that that basically are sharing their childhood traumas and doing the career rundown. I respect it. I respect the willingness to share with absolute strangers, cheer them on. Combine that with a little bit of sun and earthquake, and I can imagine it's Washington Square. It's probably a nice recipe for a fun afternoon. Just on the earthquake, I don't know if you saw. Did you see the Empire State Building's response?
Yeah, I
thought it was wonderful. Basically, a simple tweet just saying like, "I'm okay." And it's really top of mind for us. We're conducting a pitch next week for a large property holding group that has a few famous destinations. And one of the things that we're trying to illustrate, if you look at what they currently do, it's what you would expect from a conservative property business. It's relatively, how do I say this without shooting myself in the foot? It's relatively bland. But you're trying to show the extremes of famous landmarks that have developed a personality and are interacting with the world in a much more interesting way. And that was one example that we cited. I thought it was very timely. Tragedy strikes in city. Luckily, nothing, from what I understand, was, you know, any major damage or anything. And suddenly you have just this like wonderful tone of voice. Give me a quick view on that. You know, these seemingly random institutions that just develop a tone of voice online and really win.
If you think that, like, it's one of those industries that probably never had to think about that, right? Until maybe the social media age, like building companies, they probably had their business model was very much build it and they will come, right?
Yeah.
And now there's just a lot more competition. And so one day somebody in a boardroom said, right, we need to stand out here. How do we do that? Let's create a presence, an online marketing presence for our buildings. And I think, like, you're right, the Empire State Building actually do a really good job of that.
Yeah,
they have a very good social media presence. It's kind of like a, you know, any New Yorker, it's a bit of a character in your life here. I remember there's also a building, I can't remember which one, that they have an app that people can pay to change the colors on the building. I don't think it's the Empire State Building, but it's something similar.
It is the Empire State Building, by the way.
It is the Empire State Building.
So this is where, and I could be talking absolute nonsense, but I will tell you a story. I remember being on, what is it called, 260 and 5th. You know the rooftop bar that's not far from the Empire State Building, very central near Flatiron. I remember being on top of there, and I see a guy chatting up a group of girls, and he pulls out his phone, and like he starts asking them his favorite color. So imagine he's chatting, he's trying to charm, he asks him his favorite color, one of them says yellow, and he changes the Empire State to yellow. And I go, what an audacious flex. Yep. Imagine the power. I believe, and he probably should have been fired if he just worked for Empire State Building, if they knew how that technology was being used. But I definitely respected it. So maybe it is the Empire, maybe it's something else.
Yeah. Well, there you go, right? So, like, these buildings are now thinking, what's a creative way we can, you know, engage people on a level beyond what they used to? And yeah, like, the festival, they have their quirk, right? Like, there's different colors every week to represent some kind of holiday. So they'll usually post about that. The earthquake was really interesting because it was, like, it was the best thing I could compare it to was, like, sending a push notification to every single person in the city. And so, like, it made a lot of sense for localized brands to jump on it. I got a push notification from Dig In, which is like a local fast casual restaurant, which was like 20% off your lunch, use the code Quake. Right? Just like super simple, because every single person in the city is thinking about this thing. So you may as well do what you can to ride off that excitement. And so like any localized brand immediately jumped on it. It was so unexpected as well. So, you know, like I respect that it's a Friday. The marketing department's probably, you know, starting to think about their 2 p.m. finish. And a lot of them had to jump on this super quick. So I do respect it. But yeah, I agree. Like we're now starting to see buildings like very kind of historic industries that probably never had to think about marketing now have to think about what does our social media strategy look like?
Yeah. It's a fun time to be a marketeer. because, you know, the creative remit often had such rigid guardrails that at times you could argue it wasn't fun. And now the fact that we have, or it's become socially acceptable, and the lines between, we've talked about this before, brand guidelines are no longer a thing. It's kind of brand identity. It's a little looser. The definitions of identity are evolving, and I think it's a fun time to work for a brand or a company that is willing to give you permission to play like that. On the topic of interesting social media, let's say, hacks, did you see Billie Eilish invited every single person in the world or whoever followed her to be a close friend? I didn't get the invite, so I was a little offended that 110 million people were considered close friends of Billie Eilish, and I wasn't. But give me your thoughts. What happened, and why was it interesting?
Have you ever heard a Billie Eilish song?
Yes, of course I have. I have pitched Billie Eilish to many sustainable companies as a eco warrior and a authentic voice to represent them. And I quickly found out that no brands can afford her, and she won't sell her soul as quickly as most celebrities will for, you know, that green piece of paper that the world spins on.
Yeah, I mean, I think it was super smart, but it was interesting for me because, so, you know, for those of you who don't know, she basically added her whole following, her whole follower list, which is, I think, over 100 million people, to her Instagram close friends to then announce her new album. And turned out that it was a partnership with Instagram, with Meta. And to me, it's interesting because it's actually kind of an abuse of that feature in a way, right? Where close friends is obviously heavily reserved for, you know, close friends. And it feels like when you do that, you kind of drops the trust of that feature a little bit, where if I see myself on a close friend and it isn't somebody I recognize, am I now going to second guess whether it's legitimate or am I about to be sold something? So I was surprised that Meta were very happy to do that. But it also feels to me like they saw this as an opportunity to become a big part of a huge cultural moment, right? So like, this is a social media platform who is looking for some kind of edge over, you know, in the attention economy. And an interesting strategy for these platforms is, okay, how do we work with the most influential people to be a big part of their rollout or their announcements, right? And actually breaking one of their features, right? And giving Billie Eilish access to, we spoke about it a few weeks ago, right? Like intrusive marketing. It's actually a little bit intrusive if you think about it. Now, luckily they're doing it with an artist who is so beloved and has such a strong fan base that it kind of works in the other direction, but you can see it going wrong. If it was, let's say, I don't know, the UK government adding me to my close friend's story, it's the kind of thing that's going to get a lot of hate.
Get away, so, you're a machine. You go way back in your, you know, old on the edge. I'm sure you sauntered and had a glass of port together.
That's a bad example because he's already in my close friend. So, But you know what I mean? It could have been interpreted quite badly. But I think they did a good job of selecting the right person for that kind of activation. And for me, it was an indication that these platforms, they want to be part of these moments. And they're willing to go above and beyond to help their most influential creators.
I think you're being hypersensitive by being offended about an abuse. I think you used the word abuse of trust. You really are turning into a New Yorker. An abuse of trust by having a partnership. No, I'm joking, but I do agree with you that Billie, it was a big moment. It trended on every single social platform. I believe within a week, she had gained nearly 10 million followers, went from 109 million to 119 million. Hugely successful. The lesson for me in marketeers is not, are you big enough and have enough cultural cachet and leverage to broker a partnership with Meta, because that's just unrealistic for most. But I do think it's the wisdom in the whole execution is, you're trying to find spaces, or you're trying to use psychological triggers to create conversation. Mm-hmm. I remember a time when we would often turn a social account private, and you'd offer something to those that follow. It was used as a growth hack. And this to me was just a very smart growth hack, B, a way to capture earned attention and leverage curiosity and debate. It was a way to harness the collective voice of a huge fan base. Billie Eilish doesn't just have fans. She has like disciples of people that adore her.
Yep.
That's kind of one of her things. So the fact that it was very authentic for someone like her to bring her fan base closer, even if they're not like closer, I'm using in inverted commas. So yeah, there's a lot I liked about it. It reminds me that these spaces that we market in are playgrounds, and they're nuanced, and we don't just have feed, we don't just have DMs, we don't just have stories, we don't just have filters. It's all part of the same ecosystem. And if you're clever enough and you know what assets you have an opportunity to use these spaces in really creative ways. So
yep.
I was a fan. You're definitely oversensitive if you thought it was a breach of trust. But I will forgive you, Kai. You've lived in New York a while right now.
I said abuse of the feature. I didn't say abuse of the trust. Right? So like they've taken a feature, they've broken it for a start. That's a pretty significant thing for a social platform to do, in my opinion.
Wow. This is why you're all Farcaster in. This would never happen on Farcaster.
Exactly. Exactly. It's just
democratized internet.
Exactly. It sums up. We're all willing. Yeah. It's all fun and games till Facebook delete your account. It's part of a marketing campaign.
Did I ever tell you, like, there was a period of time, and it seems to have died down now before they introduced verification. Did I tell you a time where I was consistently getting my account cloned?
Oh, yeah. I do remember that. Well, I saw it happen a few times, yeah.
Yeah, so my Instagram account was getting cloned time and time again. And whoever was cloning me were messaging people, and it like mirrors everything I do. If I upload a picture, it's all there. Mirrors a similar amount of followers, similar amount of likes, all of that. It's very indistinguishable. They would change one word in my name or put a dot somewhere, or, you know, and there was multiple variations. You would report it, they would get taken down, but not really. And I found out it literally, and this is, I say it kind of jovially, but it was a really serious issue, and there was nothing I could do to control it. I tried back channels and everything. But I had multiple people literally get scammed and thousands of dollars be sent. My cousin nearly got scammed. I got a phone call from my dad one day that's like, oh, yeah. Peter's about to send the money. He's asked, instead of crypto, can he do it with a credit card? I'm like, and this would happen on a daily basis. I believe someone that was affiliated with our work got scammed. One of our clients did. I was on a flight and a client called me and said, hey, I'm panicking now. I've sent the money. I'm like, this was really serious stuff. So I tried to back channel this through Meta. And the reason I say doing a publicity stunt with Billie Eilish isn't a serious problem and a breach of a platform feature is because they really did have shit to fix. And it seems to have died down now, whatever they've done. But this was like a major problem. Anyway, I digress, dude. I am going to go into... I want to stay on the topic of kind of social media growth hacking. I had a conversation with Flight 3, our Web3 team, and we were talking about questing. So for anyone that isn't familiar, questing is a, let's say, a popular gamified way to incentivize users and early adopters to participate in often promoting a project. So there will be effectively bounties. If I write a vlog or an article about a certain project or protocol, I will be rewarded. If I do X, Y, and Z, I will be rewarded. And people are building out these solutions, and it's really about sort of, I suppose, co-authoring a marketing plan with adopters in Web3. Firstly, what are your thoughts on questing, and are there lessons for big brands to learn from these kind of gamified mechanics.
Yeah, it's crypto's in a really interesting window right now where there is a huge amount of VC funding, which is, you know, powering a lot of big protocols, big blockchains that are all competing for the same market share, right? And basically none of these companies make money or make any profit, at least. And so we're in this window right now where the only name of the game is market share and growth. Yep. And as a result, you have a lot of these tactics which are being used to essentially drive a huge amount of traffic or a huge amount of usage by incentivizing the end user with money, with some kind of reward for completing an arbitrary action. Yeah. You think about, remember when you had this kind of golden era where Uber, Airbnb, all these apps were super cheap and they were being basically funded by VC firms. And yep. I remember when I moved to New York, I could get an Uber across the city for $5. It was, you know, VCs were funding my lifestyle. It was amazing. And gradually over time, those, you know, prices have increased and it's too late. I'm stuck into the app. And so I think crypto is going through that similar phase right now. The major problem they have with all of this is that you have this other dynamic working on the other side, which is that there are a huge number of people who are generally tend to be in lower income countries where the value of the dollar is much higher, who are basically sitting all day completing these arbitrary tasks. And we call it farming the rewards that they get from it. And that is allowing them to, you know, pay, you know, put food on the table for their family, because it doesn't make sense for somebody living in the US or the UK to do this, because the value of the airdrop they receive just isn't powerful in the economy that we live in. But in these lower income places where, you know, the value of the dollar is much higher, they're able to actually make a good income from it.
Yeah.
And so when you put these two things together, you have these big, you know, VC-backed projects, which are, you know, having these questing things, which it's usually some kind of flow where it's like complete a transaction or mint an NFT and you'll complete a quest. And if you complete 5 quests, you'll get $10, right? That kind of very simple flow. They're turning that button on. You have 100,000, 200,000 people on the other side completing these tasks, but it isn't sticky behavior. It's not getting an Uber, right? Or it's not booking an Airbnb where I'm getting some kind of valuable experience that is, you know, changing the way that I go about my day to day. It's completing a task which isn't actually bringing me much value or changing the way I live my life. And when you combine these two things, what you're getting is a huge amount of arbitrary, non-sticky behavior, which when that VC money runs out and they're unable to reward users for this behavior, they're not going to continue to do the thing. And so what's going to happen one day is, you know, these quests will stop, the activity will stop. I liken it to, you know, you're going to be in the nightclub and the lights are going to come on and there's going to be no one there. And so it's an interesting dynamic where the projects that are winning are the ones who are figuring out how to do this, but to reward sticky behavior. How do I reward developers? How do I reward builders and creators who can use my platform or my tools to do something long-term? There's a very delicate balance to strike.
Yeah. I think it's a good observation, and I can clearly say you're very bullish on questing from your optimism and positivity. As you were describing that, it takes me back to the real dangers of misguided incentives. I think often of the infancy of social media growth hacking. You go onto Facebook, comment, tag 3 people for your chance to win, retweet and share, like, engage with this live. These algorithmic hacks that resulted in people that have the incentive. You would have hordes of kind of middle-aged people that like were unemployed, would like enter every competition while they're spending loads of time on Facebook on a premium brand. And there was such a disconnect, but the incentive for the marketing teams were, we are being asked to grow our Facebook channel. We're being asked to create followers. And it was a misguided incentive. And we see it's very easy to fall into these dangerous traps of chasing things that give you short-term rewards. And if I extrapolate a little there, it's the way I tend to view even things like influencer marketing. You know, yes, you could do a short-term partnership with someone to talk about your brand once. And as Tim Dillon describes, your influencers being barcodes with legs. You know, this you're paying people to try and sell things. This is what social media influence became. There is a reality that, like, really authentic collaborations and partnerships on a long-term basis where you work with people to talk about the different products and services you offer on a, you know, in a much deeper, more interesting way, that's the way to execute. And I think in marketing, we're always at this tension. We're always stuck between the tension of short-term, fast, quick hacks, six-pack in 6 week mentality activity versus the reality of doing the thing we all want, sustainable growth, brands and reputation, an image that permeates culture. And unfortunately, those things we all pursue and chase, there are no shortcuts. There aren't any shortcuts. It's just a compounding of just doing the right things relentlessly for a long time.
Yeah.
Yeah, shortcuts can give you sprints towards your next goal. But fundamentally, it's not an easy tension to, I suppose it's not easy to get harmony between those two tensions. How do you think about your, I suppose, long-term goals with Third Web and maybe some of the short-term opportunities you're presented with? What are some of the variables you think about?
So a big thing is, you know, we have to change our measurement. There's a lot of noise in this industry. Like I said, there's a lot of low quality, non-long-term activity happening. And so we actually have to put a huge amount of filters into our data to determine what is real usage. The big kind of secret in Web3 and crypto is that there just aren't many users. There are a very small amount of people who actually have a crypto wallet and, you know, do things with Web3 every single day. Now, the reason the industry is interesting is because the value of each user is much higher than a regular user, because you are so close to the point of transaction. There is thousands of dollars in these people's wallets, and they are one click away from spending a huge amount of it, right? So you have this, like, very valuable industry, very valuable user to extract from. But in general, there's also a lot of noise. And so, and we're seeing this across a lot of teams, is they actually now have to change what their measurement is. And so they determine, like, what is a high-value user? What is somebody who is actually using the technology properly? And our long-term vision is really aligned with how to increase those numbers. But also a huge amount of our work is abstracting away the blockchain. Like, how do we create apps that actually mimic regular internet behavior that people are used to doing, but use the blockchain as the technology powering it, because it's cheaper or because it unlocks some kind of novel behavior for the user?
Yeah.
That's it, really. Anything else is noise. And, like, we don't participate in quests. For this reason, we don't participate in any kind of behavior which we think is going to artificially inflate our numbers, because that's not what we report on. We're never going to send to our investors. So, like, you know, to be clear, we have, like, between 50,000 to 100,000 people actually log into our platform every day. We don't report those numbers because a huge amount of them are people who are using our tools to farm some kind of airdrop, as I kind of explained earlier. Yeah. So we report on other things, which is, like, how many developers are using our tools to generate revenue or actually have an app that has usage, right? So just going deeper down the funnel.
I think it's an important point you raise around not just having about the right incentives, but it's very easy to get hooked on the wrong things.
Yeah.
You're so right about if your one measure of success is how many, just the headline number of users, you're right, they're probably not the right users. They may be using the platform in ways that you don't want them to, et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah.
I think there's a broader point. I remember, you know, when we used to, Media Chain,
we'd run. I remember just looking at the incentives that were in the business, and you know, there was one point where I believe one in five people in the world saw something that we produced out of our offices.
Yeah,
like an obscene, like in one month, in our peak month, we had more collective online reach than like Disney, Warner. There was just, you name every major IP, creative media incumbent, and collectively we reach more people online. You know, a group of kids in Manchester.
Yeah.
And what always struck me is, I think that's a prime example where we got hooked on the wrong metrics.
Yeah.
It was growth at all costs, not build media properties that curate and create real value in the world, which led to a couple of behaviors that were, we would optimize creative that was just shareable and snackable. So like, yep, memes became the currency, and we became exceptional at memes, and the company grew, and the numbers that we reported on grew very quickly. But when it came to a point when you had to commercialize, you had to have quality of audience, all of these things that really matter for a media entity, we preserved none of that. And it was a recipe for disaster, and in turn wasn't very successful, right?
Yep.
You know, certainly commercially anyway, for the scale and opportunity. And all that stems from one simple error, the wrong incentive, which is kind of wild when you think about it.
Yep. One of the first things someone said to me was, you move what measures.
Yes.
Right. So whenever I stand up at my team meeting every Monday and say, this is the number we're tracking, it's probably the number we're going to end up working towards moving. And so getting rid of any noise and not fooling yourself with, you know, arbitrary metrics, it can be really detrimental. It can kill your business.
Yeah, I remember hearing of having a conversation with our marketing team, and they got really fixed on reporting the easy aggregated metrics, impressions, the cardinal sin.
Yep.
And I go, I care about one thing. How are we producing content that has people knock on our door and say, hey, we want to work with you?
Yep.
That was the only metric that mattered to me. Like, literally, yep. Maybe there's a correlation with reach. Maybe. I say maybe. But that, like, that's not the goal. We were all orientating. I think it's a nasty habit company. A lot of companies get into.
Yep.
A lot of companies get into that habit.
I'll say it again. I've never reported impressions figures at Third One. Like, ever. On any social platform.
Ever. You never just fancied, like, throwing out a couple of mil. Since we started...
I really don't see the point. It doesn't feel tangible, right? So, like, I can see how many people come, you know, how many people click on a Third Web link from Twitter. I report on that. That's interesting to me.
Yeah.
But impressions for the sake of impressions, I actually don't look at them. I don't know if you've looked at Twitter's analytics are broken anyway, so you can't see them. And I actually don't mind that. YouTube's slightly different, where, like, views are obviously important. But for a lot of social channels, I agree. I think impressions is maybe a hot take, but they're a bit of a vanity metric.
You heard it here first, folks. Impressions don't matter. It's kind of interesting because I don't think, unless you're deep within the weeds or you work a strategic or insight role, you don't know the variables. I understand why the industry uses impressions, because it's the only way to get a somewhat accurate view across many territories and many platforms. I'll give you an example. And I don't know if this is still true today, but to measure a single view on browser, on a live view on Twitch, you had to be on browser for 5 minutes. It was like one view was 5 minutes of viewing. Conversely, at the time, Facebook, Meta, Instagram was 3 seconds. I think it dropped to 2 seconds to qualify as a view on pre-roll, right? So... you look at that contrast of going, hey, I've got 5,000 people tuning in live. That means those 5,000 people have been sat there for 5 minutes as opposed to slowly scrolling while I look over there, right? So we're not comparing apples and oranges. We're comparing fucking melons and nectarines. Wow, that was a stretch. You get what I was saying. So yeah. I understand why we do what we do. Impressions is universal, little trivial touch. And I suppose there may be some merit if you can get some correlations between meaningful metrics, but yeah, fundamentally useless to use in any reporting. Dude, I want to kind of just segue into another topic that is top of mind for me. Increasingly, I am seeing a rise in a type of personal brand identity that I think isn't good for the people doing it, and I don't think it's a healthy trend for the startup and entrepreneurial community to pursue. Basically, more often than not, I'm seeing like this massive rise in entrepreneurs, founders, people building businesses, CEOs, etc., being really vulnerable. And on one hand, I applaud vulnerability. They're sharing stories of their failures. They're saying business is really hard. All of this may be true. But the problem I have with it is negativity sells. And yes, on one hand, if you're operating a business and you share a story that is vulnerable, you're much more likely for people to engage with you. But engagement doesn't tell you the full story. Engagement tells you there's an acknowledgement. And the problem is, often we don't consider the cost of our communication, particularly if you run a business. If you run a business, you have so many stakeholders that everything you do, and it's a privilege, by the way, but everything you do is held to account. So when I put out words or ideas into the world, I have to think, will this impact our clients? What will my team think of this? Does it impact them? What will investors, shareholders, partners think of this? There are so many stakeholders. And the problem with kind of maybe sharing certain vulnerabilities or celebrating your failures on a too frequent basis is, yes, you will be applauded on social media and you'll get the digital affirmation, the likes, the engagement. But at what cost? What signals are you sending to the world? I don't want to go work for a founder that is burnt out. I don't want to, it may be the truth, but I don't want to go like deploy an annual contract and spend my time and back a partner that's just told me like 10 things that went wrong. Like there is like just there's an impracticality to the behaviors I'm seeing in the startup community. And the reason I say I'm conflicted, because part of me admires the fact that anybody is willing to be vulnerable, to be authentic. But I think people are doing it for the wrong reasons. I think they're doing it because they're getting strong digital affirmation that I think has a net negative cost when they think of all the responsibilities that you probably have if you're running a startup or any business for that matter.
Yeah, it's really a dangerous loop where, like you said, negativity sells. I have a friend who, he's a kind of YouTube expert. He previously had like a million subscriber YouTube channel in the UK. He now consults some of the biggest entrepreneurs and brands on their YouTube growth. And he posted in a kind of side-by-side comparison of a kind of entrepreneurial creator on YouTube. One title said, 10 businesses that never fail.
Sure.
And then the next video was 10 businesses that always fail. And the second video had like 10 times the views. Because there is for some reason, that negative positioning, that negative framing, responds better to people. People are more likely to click it. They, you know, there's an element of, what's the word? Freud? What is it? I can't think of what it.
You sound like trying to describe hyperluxury.
There's an element of, I can't think of the word. You know, people tend to feed off negativity, and they probably get some kind of some. Yes, God, I'm completely lost my words there.
No, it's misery loves company, right? It's
yeah.
Like,
what's the
a sentiment?
Yeah, they feel better about themselves if they see other people failing, right? I think there's a number of psychological tricks there.
Yeah,
and you know when somebody is like struggling to get 10 likes, they're not really getting anywhere with their content, and then the first thing they post, they say, "God, today was a shit day. I fucked up, and like the client hates me." And they get 200 likes, and everyone in the comments is like, thank you for your honesty and authenticity. It's like, oh, okay, well, this is what I'm going to post now. And I think you're right. Nobody sees the hidden cost of a client looking at them and saying, maybe I don't. And it might not even be, I don't want to work with this person because they're not competent. But it might be, I don't want to work with this person because I don't want to put more on their plate.
Yes.
I don't want to like, you know, stress them even more than they already are. It's a really, really dangerous game to play. And I think the kind of personal brand game that a lot of people are playing, they're probably not thinking entirely about, like, what is the end goal there?
But I think we have to recognize how we cannot be detached from our in real life behaviors. There is not a world where I would walk into the office and go, fucking entrepreneurship, like chewing glass, no money in the bank, boom.
Yeah.
God, I've got 50 people complaining at me all day, problem after problem. Like, but we would do that online. I say we metaphorically, but the community is quite happy to do that online. But there isn't a world, yet everybody that you're associated with, your network are viewing it. So I think it's far too easy when you're behind a screen and the cost is invisible. And you see this all the time. We talk about, you know, the missed cost, the opportunity cost, the invisible cost of like pissing someone off through a bad automation email that goes out and annoys customers. Like there are so many costs. And I just encourage, like, I think there's room to be honest and vulnerable, but just don't get hooked on it becoming your identity. I see it with some of our partners and clients that are maybe, I'm aware are having a difficult time, or even my friends. I have friends that might have a difficult time. But there's part of me just wants to grab hold and be like, bro, just dial it back. It's not really my place to be counselling people around me. However, there's just part of me just goes, just dial it back. Come on.
I think the second point I'll say, and this is more for consuming this kind of content, I'm very, very, I try and be very disciplined about not paying any attention to personal brand or entrepreneurial content anymore. And that is because there is an industry around it.
Right.
So there are people who are now A/B testing content to reach your feeds, and you should pay no attention to it whatsoever. And that also comes from a place of being very close to a lot of people who create this kind of content. And like, the truth is, they're all lying. Like, let's be really honest here. Most of what you read is a lie. And like, you know that, I know that. And I don't think that's a problem, because there is an industry there. And, you know, you need to create the stuff to get the right clicks and get the views. When I say lie, I mean, it's usually, you know, slightly inflated, or the truth has been bent in order to receive the engagement they want. So you shouldn't really consume it, because you're being sold a different story to what the reality is. And I just try and avoid any of it, to be honest.
So you're telling me that Gary Vee isn't obsessed and spending all his spare time searching through garage sales to make £3. You're telling me that Alex Harmozy is not drinking a gallon of egg whites because it's cheap, despite being a millionaire that sells courses and whatever else. You're telling me that Andrew Tate, who does Hustlers University, isn't selling propaganda and the Matrix narrative to cultivate young impressionable minds to join his school and pay $40. You're telling me that there's industry behind everything we see online? Get out of here, Catman.
The thing is, I don't watch any of those people, so I don't know.
I must be in the algorithm of the like chauvinistic hustle porn entrepreneur cycle. Yes, I am unfortunately aware of many of these people, some of which have some okay ideas. I don't want to be facetious and be that guy that slags everyone off, but
no, I think you should absolutely take that. Like, there's a lot of value out there, and there's a lot of things to filter through. But I generally think it's a dangerous game to apply it or to compare yourself too much to how these people operate, because, you know, I don't know how hard line to go here, but I would say it's just apply a filter, right? I think is the best way to go.
I think inherently we all, it's a very human trait to, you know, have heroes and put people on a pedestal and It's interesting to see all these stories come out about people. Everyone is rooted in a story.
Mm-hmm.
And I just think we're just appealing to like the most innate parts of us.
Yeah.
In humans, our vulnerabilities, etc. And people that understand that, whether consciously or unconsciously, they take advantage of human nature. But yeah. I cannot say, we are in the business of marketing, so I would be wildly hypocritical if I said we didn't try and influence, but our entire job is capture people's attention.
Exactly.
And do this type of stuff. Dude, just on the topic, it is linked, I suppose, loosely to personal brand. It appears to me LinkedIn is going on a very aggressive pursuit to becoming a bit of an everything social media app in many respects. I think for some time, LinkedIn's been a bit of a hidden gem, and I'm now seeing businesses emerge around LinkedIn influencers. I'm now seeing, you know, LinkedIn consistently beta test new features that move them closer. Some of the features that came out recently, a video feed. They've been reported to be testing a video feed where a complete segment just for loops of video content. There's many features where they're encouraging people to co-author articles and participate in all these kind of incremental features. And now LinkedIn gaming is going to be a thing. I only read the headlines. I didn't read exactly what that meant, but I do think it speaks to a broader point on LinkedIn is quickly becoming, let's say, less of a B2B social media app and maybe just a social media app. What do you think? What's going on? What's your take?
LinkedIn is the new Facebook, I think. Sounds like.
You think? LinkedIn is the new Facebook? As cool as Facebook?
No, but LinkedIn is the only app, the only social media app that I can scroll on at work and get away with it. Because somebody glances at my screen, I'm just doing some recruitment. No, but I think LinkedIn is really powerful for that reason, right? Like, it's a lot of people at work during the day, during their lunch break, and I think they accidentally stumbled across this very powerful type of content, which was the personal brand, right? They are the home of the professional influencer, the home of the personal brand. And if you think about the value of that audience, it's very high. Like, you look at Instagram, you look at YouTube, you might have the biggest creator there. Let's take Mr. Beast, who has hundreds of millions of subscribers and viewers. Huge portion of them, maybe more than 50%, are children with no disposable income and, you know, no way of spending any money. You have the biggest creators on LinkedIn. 90% of their followers are professionals with a huge amount of disposable income. So you just have a very valuable network.
Mm.
And that is why I think we've seen such a huge, quick rise in terms of LinkedIn's growth. And like you said, they're now kind of investing into innovation a lot quicker than we've ever seen. And so it makes a lot of sense. And I think this is also just another example of every social media app is kind of converging and starting to look the same. They'll probably have a vertical video feed. They'll probably have, I think they tried stories, right? It's just going to be the same experience on any app that we choose. And so I don't know how that's going to play out, but yeah, to me, this makes a lot of sense. And I know a lot of people who are building businesses around LinkedIn influencers, building businesses around creators on that platform, and it isn't going to go away.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. Believe it or not, Catman, I have been called a LinkedIn influencer. I have also been referred to in public as "you're the LinkedIn guy." I've never had more disdain for that as my brand. I always felt I was cooler than being LinkedIn guy. But maybe as LinkedIn becomes cooler, maybe that tag isn't so bad. I will tell you my favorite thing about LinkedIn is it's probably the most positive community on the internet. It's the safest social media space because you have this safeguarding that your employer, your colleagues, people, there's no anonymity.
it's linked to all the people where you present your best self. So on one hand, it becomes a very positive community and uplifting. You could argue there's an element of fakery to it, but sure. Where isn't fakery on the internet and in social media? And then there's part of me, when I think of that, that I just deeply respect. You know those trolls on LinkedIn that just don't care? I go, you've got everyone you know and you're still willing to be that guy.
Yep.
You're still willing to be like homophobic or sexist. And I'm like, wow, that is audacious.
Yep.
I go, come on. But yeah, overall, net positive for me, LinkedIn. I've been a huge benefactor in terms of, I think I learn a lot from the space. I've curated. I follow a lot of interesting people on my professional interests. I will say there are some criticisms of the algorithm now. You know, I think in the probably the last 12 months, we've seen the most radical shift in algorithm. In terms of, you know, historically, velocity comments were the primary signals that would create earned reach. Now they're really putting relevancy and first-party connections front and center. So you tend not to get the same earned reach that you typically would, that you used to through second and third-party connections. But that's not necessarily a bad thing. I just think it's all... Platforms survive when they serve the right people the right thing. So yes, it's a little more challenging to growth hack, you could say. I think more people are recognizing the value and creating, so that creates congestion and competition. But overall, I'm a huge fan, and I will give credit to the team. I've worked with, through agency work, but a lot of creator teams. And LinkedIn has one of the best, one of the most helpful, one of the most responsive, incredibly thoughtful, nice team that really are championing the community. So I respect the fact they're making the investments and effectively building a kind of newfound, a new frontier for the creator economy. No longer are creators just barcodes with legs. I love that phrase. Mm-hmm. But you know, you can have influence and a voice and be a, you know, a professional, and it can be part of your professional identity. So yeah, I'm a big fan. On that note, I actually have a massage booked in 25 minutes, so I am going to love you and leave you. I'm going to I'll leave it there, actually, because I don't need to explain anymore. You know, when you start over-explaining something, it sounds seedy, and it definitely wasn't meant to be. It was literally, I've got a bit of a cold coming on. And again, I'm over-explaining, but on that note, memes and machines.
Fine.
Good to see you, man.
Good to see you.